Hey everyone, I'm Geoff Keighley, and welcome to a special Game Awards pre-show panel, Gaming's Next Decade. You know, every year at the Game Awards, we get to showcase lots of great games and celebrate incredible developers, but we don't get to do a lot of talking. The show is super fast-paced and filled with trailers and announcements, so I was really excited about the idea today to host a special pre-show panel, talk about the state of the gaming industry, where we've been, where we're going. I know everyone watching this is, you know, very passionate about gaming like I am. So I thought we'd sort of have a great conversation before we get into the Game Awards today. And it is a big day for gaming, and certainly it's been a big year for gaming for all of us around the world who've enjoyed games, but I think also appreciate how much gaming has done to comfort and connect the world. So we put together an all-star panel today to talk about the state of gaming. So I want to welcome virtually, of course, Dr. Lisa Su, the CEO of AMD, Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox, and Laura Miele, the Chief Studios Officer at Electronic Arts. Hi, guys. Welcome to our virtual panel.
Hello.
Hey, it's good to be here.
Great to have you guys here. Well, this is a big day for the industry, the Game Awards, and I'm honored to have all three of you on our advisory board for the Game Awards to help us shepherd this show in what has been a challenging year for everyone around the world. But I think we all agree that gaming has really had an important role in bringing people together. So before we get into, you know, future casting on where games are going to go and whatnot, I really just wanted to open this with just sort of hearing from all of you guys about reflecting back on 2020 and gaming, what I think is, you know, increasing sort of prominence and role and relevance in culture in 2020. Maybe Phil, we'll start with you. Like, what is your perspective on you know, how this year has been different than other years for this industry?
Jeff, I think you said it right when you talked about gaming's role in culture. And what does that mean for our industry? What responsibilities do we take on? What are we as an industry? What's our makeup as teams? What voices do we empower through the art form of video games? It's been an incredibly stressful year for teams trying to get work done in new ways, and incredible kudos to all the developers who are both at the Game Awards, but did such incredible work under amazing circumstance to get some incredible things done. But I think your point about culture and our role in community and our role as a discourse for great discussions in video games, either between our community or in the products themselves, is an incredibly important thing for the industry to really internalize.
Yeah. Lisa, I wanted to ask you about, you know, you guys have incredible story with AMD being, you know, inside, you know, both the new consoles launching and an exciting time for sort of technology of gaming. But I'm curious for you, because you look at the entire sort of, you know, computing ecosystem. What have you seen as sort of gaming's role in 2020?
Well, you know, I think, Geoff, first of all, it's great to be here with you and Phil and Laura. And, you know, I think 2020 has really been like a confluence of events, right? If you think about it, you know, it was always going to be a big year for gaming with, you know, all the new technologies, the new consoles, the new PC technologies, the new cloud technologies all coming together. But I think it's really been punctuated by the fact that, you know, this year has been, you know, very, very unique for all of us. And as a result, it's become even more important to the points that Phil made about just being, you know, being a medium to actually bring people together. And, you know, I think it's just a phenomenal way for people to interact when they can't be in the same room together. So I do think, you know, 2020 has been a very special year for gaming, and it's just shown the importance of really bringing the community together.
Yeah, and Laura, your teams have done incredible work, you know, shipping games and consoles being shipped. I mean, I think some of the audience doesn't fully appreciate how hard it's been, you know, for all this content still to come out. But you have such an interesting perspective, you know, across all of EA's games and live service titles and everything. I'm curious to get your perspective on, and someone that I've known, you know, in the industry for multiple decades. How has 2020 felt different for you, you know, from your perspective?
Yeah, well, hello, everyone, and thank you, Geoff and Lisa. It's great to see both of you and be here together with everyone in such an unusual year. And in so many ways, everything has changed. Phil touched on what it means to develop games in a year like this. And of course, we're all discussing what it means to socially connect and to fight the isolation and fear that the pandemic has brought to so many people and the role that gaming has played in that. And I think that in many ways, the pandemic is going to pull the future forward in how we think about innovation and social design and connection and how we bring people together in more meaningful ways. I think the expectations are going to continue to be high in that area.
Yeah, I think that's such a great point that gaming and gaming technology has been, you know, used in so many interesting ways. And it's obviously the games that we love, but I look at, you know, the whether it's a concert in Fortnite or, you know, the virtual sets that people are doing at these events, all powered by kind of games and game technology, which is exciting to see that this industry has such a leadership position and opportunity moving forward. But, you know, at the core of it all, of course, are great games, great experiences. And this year, I think I'm still amazed that, you know, a new Xbox, a new PlayStation came out around the world, which, again, is just so phenomenal. It's such a special year anyways, and a special year, you know, that AMD technology is inside both of those machines. And I wanted to sort of move a little bit to this, you know, dawn of a new generation, which, you know, we only get usually every 6 or 7 years. This was one of those years. And I'm really curious to sort of talk about, you know, what we can expect. And I think a lot of people watching this, you know, may be lucky enough to have a system or maybe waiting for one, but get excited about the future potential of this industry. And that's something that I've always loved about games is at this intersection of entertainment and technology. And that means, you know, this year's games are great, but the ones in the future are going to, you know, only get even better. Maybe we'll start with you on this, Laura. Like, we obviously have heard lots about, you know, faster load times and, you know, other, you know, great kind of technological aspects of these games, but the pure game experience, as you look at this next generation, what excites EA and the game makers there about the types of experiences that are gonna be sort of available to players with all this incredible new technology?
Yeah, it is an incredible time. Whenever new hardware releases, it's always a moment. And this one is particularly special. And it would be, you know, it's an obvious thing to say that, oh, the graphic resolution and things like talking about ray tracing, it's incredibly exciting. And graphics are beautiful and gorgeous and fidelity continues to improve. But I would say that this generation, more than any other, is about it's about innovation and immersion. The graphics is a part of the experience. Graphics is a part of the games loading faster, access to bigger worlds, audio fidelity. It's all of these things that are coming together to connect emotionally to players in a way that we have never experienced before. And so I think that the emotional relationship and connection that players are going to have to the game content is going to be unprecedented, not to mention the things such as the scale of games. We're playing, the DICE team is actually playing the next Battlefield. It is at a scale and size that we have never seen before. And so it is just, it's blowing our teams away about what is possible. And it's incredibly exciting. And it's almost as if the, you know, our imaginations are being unbound relative to where they have been before, thanks to the incredible technology from Phil and Lisa. The teams are really motivated, inspired by it.
Well, and this technology, you know, I know Lisa, I mean, you and your teams are working for years and years with these partners to sort of, you know, think about, you know, what types of features can be in these systems and what's possible. I wanted to get, you know, a little bit of perspective from you on, you know, the technologies that are inside of these consoles and PCs today. you know, what do you think they're, what is it going to enable moving forward? You said, we know great graphics, great computing power, but the types of experiences, I know you guys think, you know, about the emotion of it too, of what you want to bring to the end user. Maybe give us a bit of perspective of, from AMD of, you know, what you're hoping the experiences will be that will come out of the technology that you're putting into these machines.
Well, look, you know, we love the fact that we can bring so much technology to so many people. I mean, if you just think, you know, you were commenting, Geoff, just a moment ago, that, you know, in the last generation of consoles, which was, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, if you think about how many people that technology touched, I mean, it was, you know, over 500 million, right? If you think about, you know, across the entire user base. And, you know, this cycle is even going to be larger when you think about, you know, consoles, PCs, and the cloud. And what we're able to do is really work so closely with our partners, you know, with Phil's team, with Laura's team, and the other game developers to really create that end-to-end experience. So, you know, I mean, I can talk to you about speeds and feeds all you want, but I mean, I think at the end of the day, it is creating that immersive experience that Laura mentioned. And it's also creating it in a way that you can experience it whichever way you want, you know, sort of wherever you want, with whomever you want, in different ways, shapes, and forms. And I think that's what we really strive to. You know, it's empowering to know that, you know, you can have, you know, sort of this technology really flow through the entire ecosystem, and that's been, you know, sort of the vision, you know, of our development.
Yeah, Phil, when you, you know, sit down with Lisa and her team and your team, think about, you know, the next generation and the types of experiences. Obviously, you know, I know part of the vision, as Lisa said, is, you know, being able to sort of scale things across multiple devices and platforms to allow, you know, the widest possible audience to experience these games. But how much do you really think about, like, the, you know, the big ideas and how, you know, how technology can enable that for this next generation? I mean, something like faster, you know, load times is a quality of life improvement, but some of those kind of bigger vision things about, you know, the worlds and the characters and those experiences, how do you go about even sort of manifesting that into a chip?
One of the cool things that people don't see, you know, I think about Lisa and Laura's team, like, we start this journey with them probably 4 years ago, where we go and talk to Lisa and her team. It's an incredible team at AMD, about the technologies they see on the horizon and how they envision these things might impact video games and the distribution of games. And then we spend that same time with the game studios and Laura's team and other third-party publishers and studios and our own internal teams, talking to them about what they can envision. And it's this long process, which I think is really just a cool part of the creation of a platform, of getting to spend time with the hardware engineers and the magicians that are there in Lisa's team, and also starting to hear from creators. And creators usually talk about the way they want their customers, gamers, to feel, right? They'll start from the, here's what I want somebody to be able to experience in my video game. They rarely start with kind of a resolution or frame rate or even load times. Like, they'll start from an immersion or an impact that they want to have on their players. And it's such a, just an incredible time when you're at that beginning of a platform and you're iterating these ideas. And I like to say it's like throwing this lawn dart 4 years in advance and hoping that you hit a target, because you don't really know where it's going to land. You don't know what the technologies that will come to bear and some of them that won't, and how the platform and the experiences really come together. And that's what's so exciting to me about the beginning of a generation, because you're just now, you're starting to see creators get their hands on the platforms, whether it's the new PlayStation, the new Xbox, and really start to push their ideas and what they want to push forward. But I thought the thing that Lisa was talking about, of the thing about accessibility to games and how the gaming is now built around me as the player, you know, it's a goal I think we should all have as an industry, that it should be as easy to play a video game as it is listen to a song or watch a video. And I think that's a real opportunity for all of us. There's a lot of friction in video games that we're used to, whether it's downloading 100 gigabytes of video games, whether it's it only runs on one piece of hardware, or any of those things. And there's still positives to that part of gaming as well, but it can't be a barrier to people getting to play the great games that Laura's teams are building. And as a platform, you know, that's what we think about, is that intersection of opportunity for creators and technical capability of the platform to really unlock more people to be able to play. I think that should be our goal.
And I know, you know, we're going to talk a lot about this, I'm sure, the changing nature, right, of, you know, these traditional console cycles and, you know, boxed products that you used to go buy. And now these games are, you know, increasingly these incredible living worlds and ongoing games that continue to build and build. And I wanted to turn to you a little bit, Lisa, on the hardware side and talk about that. And cloud, obviously, is a part of this. But I'm curious to get your perspective on kind of how hardware may become a little bit more like software. That's something that Gabe Newell talks to me a lot about, is like the idea of, you know, hardware evolving. And with cloud, we've seen, I mean, hardware can change behind the scenes and the game experience just, you know, improves over time. I'm curious to get your take on, you know, the game industry is being disrupted and changing. I'm curious on the hardware side, like, how do you look at that of, you know, sort of, you know, compute and GPU power sort of, you know, changing over time, and how does AMD look at that and the, you know, the changing nature of that in the next decade?
Well, you know, I think the exciting part about it is, you know, gaming is a perfect use case for really driving, you know, high performance compute. And, yeah, you know, again, back to why is 2020 still unique? Because I think it's really, you know, sort of, you know, really brought out the fact that, you know, tech is essential. Right. And if you look at, you know, just, you know, whether you're talking about gaming, or you're talking about, you know, work from home or school from home or any of these, you know, types of opportunities, you need good hardware, and hardware ends up being the foundation that allows you to build these incredible experiences that, you know, with Phil's team, with Laura's team, and with, you know, sort of the other third-party developers. And so we actually view ourselves as an enabling and an empowering capability with hardware. And the truth is, it is, you might consume it in all different ways, right? So right now, you know, everybody's dying to get a console. So I'm sure, Phil, it feels great to be the hottest product on the market. But there are also people upgrading PCs like they've never done before, because they want to experience you know, this incredible new capability. And yes, we push the envelope on graphics, and we push the envelope on CPUs, and we work very closely with the software developers to make sure that, you know, we can get all of the, you know, new features like ray tracing and other capabilities. But it's all to really enable that foundation of people just experiencing what technology can do for you, whether it's for entertainment or for productivity or other use cases.
And this traditional, you know, 6 or 7 year console cycle, we obviously know in the PC space, there's, you know, more iterative upgrades over time. Lisa, how do you think cloud and kind of, you know, some of these you know, technologies are going to kind of change the cycle of innovation or, you know, hardware? Like, do you have any thoughts on what that's going to look like in the future?
You know, I think we're going to continue to push the envelope, and you know, we'll you know, whether it's delivering more capability in the cloud, as well as you know, in client devices, but you know, the architectural capability is really important, and the ability to you know, play not just you know, the current games, but you know, sort of new capabilities is very important. And so, you know, we think about that with the evolution of hardware, and that's, you know, really what helps us, you know, bring all these things together. So from that standpoint, I think hardware will always continue to evolve, but I think the ability to play you know, your full suite of games is such a large piece of that, and so that's part of what we look at as well.
And on the game side, Laura, you know, EA touches almost every genre out there in one way or another. Maybe tell us a bit about, when you think of next generation, you said there's certain, you know, the kind of emotional impact of, you know, a massive immersive world, but also these games are becoming, you know, sort of living spaces, and ongoing, you know, kind of social spaces in many ways, for folks to gather. You know, I know you've been involved over the years in you know, MMOs and other types of games. What are the genres or the types of experiences that you think, you know, this new generation is going to bring forward? Like, what are the types of games that EA's game creators are most excited to build?
Well, the enablement of the technology is not just about playing games. It's also about creating in games. It's about viewing and watching games interactively. What's happening before us is we're seeing secular changes around and secular evolution, fundamental changes around how people interact with each other, how people consume media and entertainment, and the expectation that consumers in general have around having an agency or having an impact on experiences that they engage in. And so I think that what we are seeing and how we're thinking about it as we move forward into this new generation is we're thinking about playing, absolutely, people playing together, playing the games that we're creating. We're thinking about how players create, how they create with each other, building each other's ideas, and then how they watch in an interactive and social way. And social interaction and how people engage and play with each other is also a really important thread through play, create, and watch that we think is really unique to gaming. Gaming can be at the center of this. And we know that gaming is so big now. It's bigger than movies and TV. And with the unlock of the technology innovation that we've been talking about, the runway is significant.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point about the definition of what is a game. And, you know, mm-hmm. Phil and I will have these debates often about, you know, there's like single player story games, and even at the Game Awards, like, you know, people love a lot of, you know, really rich narrative, but obviously there are many different, you know, genres out there and types of experiences. And Phil, I'd love to get from a platform perspective, you know, your take on sort of the changing nature of what defines a game. As Laura said, you know, obviously Minecraft is a great example of, you know, creation being a part of the game experience. You know, do the genres and types of games in this next generation, are they going to dramatically sort of shift or change, do you think?
Well, I think to some extent they already have. And, you know, I look at the games that are up at the Game Awards, there's some amazing, amazing games from great creators. And then I'll also look at the games that are getting most of the play. And there's another set of creators, and there's some overlap between those two things, but there's another set of creators that have really focused on engagement of communities. And those aren't separate spheres of creation. I think that as a platform, what we want is to give the creators the tools to build the experience that's in their head, and enable a platform that can have amazing games like, you know, Assassin's Creed or the new FIFA or the Cyberpunk launching right now, but also be an amazing platform for something like Roblox or Minecraft or Fortnite, and to make sure that the platform's not the thing that's trying to dictate what can become popular, but rather we just give the tools and the canvas for the largest ecosystem that's out there, a large ecosystem for creators, so that they can find the largest audience. I think that the magic that game creators have really grabbed onto, that I think in music and video that they haven't quite been there, is, as Laura was talking about, that power of community. The fact that our games, and Geoff, I know you've talked about this a lot, where games are almost a platform unto themselves when they get to a certain mm-hmm. scale. And as creators, then we have to think not only about what does that mean to go launch a game and to sell it and make sure people have the right experience with it, but also over time, how do you grow and evolve that platform? And in many ways, building something like, you know, Windows or PlayStation or Xbox right now, it's about a platform of platforms, and those gaming platforms that live on top of your platform have their own sense of community and creation. And you've got business models inside of those platforms, whether it's Roblox or Minecraft and all of those creations that happen there. And it creates both a ton of complexity, but I also think a ton of opportunity of not to define what is one thing that is success for us as an industry. Because with 3 billion people playing video games today, there is not one great game. There's I'll bristle a little bit at Game of the Year, not because I don't think there's some amazing games that were created, but rather to highlight one game in a world of so many amazing things that have been brought to market. I just like celebrating the overall success in gaming. And you've done that with the Game Awards. I think you've done a really good job of bringing more creators at different stages in both their career and scale. But also when you think about EA and the work they've done to foster small games and bring them to market and Lisa and the teams at AMD, you know, PC is kind of the ultimate democratized game creation platform, both because of its iteration and openness. I think all of that just builds an amazing, amazing future for gaming.
Well, and what's so exciting about what you said, Phil, too, is that it's not just about super seasoned, experienced game developers and creators. It's about the community. Players are at the center, actually, of the industry and the experience far more than they have ever been. And it's just going to continue to go in that direction, which is just an incredibly exciting time, not only to be a game developer, but to be game players and game creators. It's so interesting.
And it's, you know, one of the things that I think we're all seeing right now is the success of Among Us, right? A game that launched over 2 years ago. You know, cool team creating a very cool game, but kind of has found its time now with COVID and other things where it's now providing a service. Not that it didn't have players before, but you've really seen it. You've seen it come to the forefront on platforms and on PC, really, and other platforms doing really well. And I think it's awesome for us that it is the players, Laura, as you say, that have the power. It's not about what launched today or what has the biggest marketing campaign or even the highest production budget, but players will find great games wherever they are. And we have the platforms as an industry to enable those games to find players and actually kind of reinflate in certain cases or reach new levels. And I think that's awesome. I'm seeing right now so many people playing Jedi Fallen Order. Like it's awesome to see people coming back to an amazing game that launched. And now I see new people finding it. And that's just something that our industry should continue to push, people finding the right game for them at the right time.
Well, I agree. Because for so long, you said there's all this great content. And then it's sort of like, you know, 2 years later, you don't think about it. You said Jedi Fallen Order, a great game a year ago. It's up for awards tonight even. And it's like, yeah, it's one of those ones that is an incredible experience. It holds up incredibly well.
Yeah.
Lisa, I want to ask a bit about the team there. And, you know, we're talking a lot about, you know, specifics on games and experiences. And I'm curious, how does AMD just conceptually, how do you translate some of those ideas into, you know, the silicon and the hardware that you guys are making? Like, I'm curious, like, you know, that sort of, you know, dreaming of sort of like where technology and graphics are going to go. Like, what is that process at AMD when you're probably even starting to think about the next generation? Like, how do you guys go about that? And how do you translate some of these big thoughts and ideas into the, you know, the actual technology that's going to bring it to life?
Yeah, no, Geoff, that's always the fun part, right? So, I mean, you can imagine, you know, a team of architects who sit there and think about, hey, what can technology do in 5 years? You know, it starts with, you know, what we think the manufacturing is capable of, and then it starts, and a lot of it is frankly the vision of our partners around, you know, where are the big rocks that we can move? And then it's putting it into reality. So if you think about, you know, just this generation, you know, what we're seeing here in 2020, it's really a culmination of the last 4 or 5 years of effort around, you know, how much, you know, processing horsepower can we put in a little box and ensure that it can do all the great things that, you know, Laura's team and Phil's team want to do. And so, yeah, the process is very iterative, but it starts with the big vision of what's possible. And then how do we make what's possible a reality? And so, that, you know, it is a really, really unique time when you see it all come together. And that's what you're seeing right now, whether you're a console gamer or a PC gamer or you're a cloud gamer, you're seeing really the culmination of what's possible from a hardware standpoint and bringing in new tech like, you know, 7-nanometer technology and, you know, RDNA, you know, 2 architecture and ray tracing and all of these things coming together. But it's really working very closely with technologists as well as our partners to figure out where the world is going.
And I'm curious for you guys, you know, all of you, it's like, there are always trade-offs, right? When you're, you know, building new games and new platforms, new chips, you know, for this next generation, like, is AI going to be the big leap forward? Is it going to be, you said we're talking, you know, a lot of talk now about ray tracing and, you know, new graphic technologies. I'm curious if any three of you have thoughts on sort of like in the next cycle, like where we're going to see the most disruptive opportunity, or maybe it is, as you said, with, you know, things working across multiple platforms or the creation engines inside of these games. Like, I'm curious if you guys have thoughts on, out of all the different sort of lanes that teams can pursue, what will be sort of the most disruptive? Is it that, you know, the characters are going to be so amazing, or the narratives are going to be more malleable? And again, different teams will approach it in different ways, but I'm curious if you guys have thoughts on sort of, you know, the most disruptive elements once we get past the faster load times and some of those other quality life improvements. Any thoughts on like what the big disruption may be in the next, you know, 4 or 5 years?
We're all just going to stare at each other.
I was going to say, if I got a call, all right, you're up first, Phil.
You know, first,
I think about this stuff, right? And it's like, I just wonder, you know, you always talk about more believable characters, or, you know, Laura mentioned Battlefield, you know, biggest battles ever. And it's like, I'm just trying to think of, you know, as gamers try and, you know, get excited, I guess, right? About the, you know, how games are going to get that much better. Maybe it is just all the levels, but I'm curious if you have any thoughts.
No, I think it's a great question. And I focus, I'm not picking on you a little bit, but the word disruption maybe is where I, because I don't see it as disruption. I see it as really unlock and accessibility. I think from a pure technical standpoint, I think one of the areas that we haven't talked a ton about, you know, on disruption, I think about accessibility. I think about how do we make more games more available to more people? And that's really an opportunity. And I do think there's some underpinnings in the technology that Lisa and the team have worked on that'll be incredibly important there. And AMD plays a real unique role on PC and on console and cloud. There's really no other silicon provider out there that has the role that they have across the surface area of so many people playing games. So, is staying in sync with Lisa and the team and sitting down, and we're doing this already and thinking about what could come, I think will be incredibly important. One of the areas we haven't talked a ton about, just because it's not as on screen today, is I think the machine learning capability of the silicon that Lisa's team is putting out now. And you know, you've seen technology that allows super sampling and recreation of certain fidelity at lower bandwidths and other things that I think are going to be really, really interesting this generation on unlocking, because of the local device capability, bringing a really high fidelity either stream or even gameplay, local gameplay, to a device that's maybe not built to perform at a certain ton of teraflop level. But there's a ton of work that the teams have done thinking about machine learning and how it will impact gaming. But one of the great things is we're always surprised. You know, if I go back to Xbox 360 and there's this little Java game called Minecraft and it launches towards the end of the generation, who would have thought that 10 years later that thing would be what it is? And that's not because we own it. The community is the ones that have driven Minecraft. So, you know, I think for any of us, we can make some bets about what might be the thing that happens. But the cool thing is that the community owns the decisions about what they play and what they invest in. And our industry does a good job on following what players want.
Yeah, I agree. I think that it's the combination of this incredibly advanced, sophisticated, complicated technology. The combination of that is actually going to bring together an accessibility that is powerful. It's hard to talk about and explain the profound impact that accessibility can have for a player and for a player experience or for a consumer experience, but it will be the most defining, powerful change in gaming will come from the accessibility, whether it be in gameplay, platform proliferation, ubiquity of games. I mean, I was talking to a friend of mine about this. Think about how we thought about iPhones. When the iPhone came out, there were a lot of smartphones on the market. You had your camera, you had an iPod, you had music capability, but the accessibility, the ease of having all these things in one place, then to have these experiences actually talk to each other, interact with each other, is something that we all can't live without and can't imagine our lives without at this point. And I really believe that this is what we are embarking on in this next generation of gaming. The bounds that we have and the barriers and limitations that were on either game developers or game players or access and friction. Phil, you talked about friction earlier in the conversation. It's hard to underestimate the power of that and the power and the impact that accessibility is going to have on our industry, on gaming for players, and dare I say, society at large.
Yeah, maybe if I just add a comment to that, I think we also underestimate just how different it really is. And, you know, a story that I was having a conversation with a person recently, and they were, you know, congratulating us on the new technology. And they just said, hey, I was in a store, you know, just looking at a 4K monitor and seeing what the new generation of products could do. And it was just completely different. And I think that's really where we're going. I mean, the fact is that the technology that we're putting into today's you know, capabilities is different. You know, it's visually stunning. It's incredibly immersive, and it is extremely accessible. You know, all of these comments, and we take for granted the fact that, you know, just a few years ago, you know, the experience wasn't like this. And so I think that's what this community is able to put together. I mean, you know, the fact is gaming is one of those places that you can see and feel the difference when the technology gets better. And I think that's why it's so much fun. And frankly, why it's growing in, you know, sort of around the world.
Yeah, no, you mentioned around the world. I think one of the things I'm always amazed with Game Awards and this industry is how global things truly are. And I wanted to talk quickly about accessibility, where we talked a lot about the accessibility of you know, games on more platforms. Tonight, we've got our first Innovation Accessibility Award that is recognizing, you know, a lot of teams that have worked hard to make games more accessible to those with disabilities. And I think one thing that all of us have thought this year is, you know, how can the gaming industry continue to grow and reach more people? As you said, Phil, you know, Satya and you have talked about, you know, 3 billion people around the planet playing games. But of course, all of us that love games want more people to experience them. And part of that, I think, is, you know, innovating and how to make games more accessible. But also, I think it's diversifying the types of people that make games, you know, that work in this industry and have as many voices coming to be a part of it. And I wanted to give all of you a bit of a chance to talk about how you're thinking about, you know, how the obligation this industry has, you know, in this position as the most powerful form of entertainment, how to get more voices involved in, you know, the creation of games and also playing games. And maybe Laura, start with you on this. I know it's something, you know, you and everyone here is passionate about, but how can our industry do more there? Because I do think people watching this have a real passion for gaming and want more people to be a part of it.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. And first I'll just start by building on what you said. The year that we've had, the importance of the content and the experiences that we put out into the world is greater today than it's ever been. So we've been talking about the new technology, we've been talking about the immersion, we've been talking about how realistic things feel. Our ability to shape society and inform culture and to shape people's points of view about the world are significant. It's more significant than any form of media. So we have a significant responsibility to be very responsible about that. And I think that from, you know, from an Electronic Arts perspective, it's something that is deep in the core values of our company. We also know and recognize that we have to show representation across leadership, across our teams, and that we have to welcome unique points of view, diverse thoughts, diverse opinions, and we have to create a culture and environment that welcomes and invites that. And then as far as the content goes, yes, we are incredibly excited and motivated to have the most diverse and broadest breadth of games that we possibly can, from The Sims to our sports games to our shooter games to Apex. We're incredibly motivated to ensure that we have, you know, a broad offering for people. And I would say that being intentional about that is really important. So we've incorporated things such as inclusion frameworks as we set out to determine characters and roles and their voices and are they the protagonists, are they antagonists in stories. It's incredibly important to be deliberate and intentional about how we create these stories, how we shape these experiences that players are going to have. Again, a really immersive worlds have a great degree of influence on how people see the world around them. So we have a big responsibility here.
Now, Lisa, any thoughts from your end on sort of, you know, the, you know, you're one of the, you know, top tech CEOs out there, and I think you've done such a great job, you know, welcoming more and more people, even at AMD, just in terms of the engineers and other folks working on this. And I think that makes, you know, just the technology and gaming industry stronger. When you think about, you know, moving forward and inviting more people to be a part of, you know, not even just gaming, but I think just, you know, computing and technology, I'm curious to get your perspective on how you think about that.
Yeah, no, look, I think we all have a role to play. I think Laura's comments were right on in terms of the inclusiveness of every aspect of what we do. You know, I think from our side, we're very focused on ensuring that, you know, the folks who are developing the technologies are a diverse population. There are more and more women in engineering and in hardware and certainly in software as well. And so I think it's an opportunity to show really just how much you can really do. I think that's the beauty of our profession, right? I mean, we can all see the fruits of the labor and, you know, can see how much, you know, one person can in fact make a difference. And so that's certainly what we try to do at AMD and really, you know, across the energy, the industry. So I think there are more and more, you know, women in gaming. I think we can use even more, Laura, right? I think you would agree with that. And, you know, part of it is just making it fun and accessible and, you know, something that, that people, you know, feel comfortable about being a part of.
Yeah. I mean, 3 billion people, Phil, but there's still some more to get, right?
I think gaming has this unique ability to bring people together through the gameplay itself, for the love of games, through things like the Game Awards. And I just think building empathy between groups by allowing more creators to tell their story and for you to feel that lived experience of creators everywhere, regardless of their physical ability, regardless of the gender, regardless of socioeconomic background, I just think that's, you called it the most powerful entertainment medium, Geoff, and I think you're absolutely right. And that's really because you have agency when you get to play. And when we talk about 3 billion people playing Satya and I don't think that's our bound, right? That's just today. I think there's a real unique opportunity for us as an industry to make sure that all of those people feel included in the industry, find stories that are either first something that they connect with, but hopefully over time, stories and games that are maybe from perspectives that they haven't felt before, and they learn through that. And our communities have to be open and inclusive to support all of that. But that is the power of gaming. You call it the most powerful entertainment media. I think you're absolutely right. And our job as industry leaders is to make sure we're shepherding this industry in the right way so that 10, 20, 30 years from now, it's not 3 billion people, it's 5 billion, 6 billion people playing, and that people find leaders and stories from that perspectives that where they can learn more. I think that's just such a great thing for us to aspire to.
Indeed.
You're here. I would agree with you on that. And it's... Yeah, it's been great to have all of you guys here today. You know, thank you for all your support and guidance on the Game Awards. You've all been there since we started back in 2014, and tonight is going to be a different show, but I think going to be hopefully exciting and a rallying moment for all of us that love games, and to all of you guys and your teams that have done so much this year on behalf of everyone watching the show that enjoys games. Thanks to all of you for coming through in what I know was not the easiest year in 2020.
Congrats on the show, Geoff. I'm sure it'll be great.
Yeah, have a great show.
Yes, awesome. Thank you. And thank you for always helping us celebrate our industry. You're an amazing leader that way.
Well, thank you. You guys are far too kind, and we'll have a great night. The Game Awards is coming up. Thanks to Lisa, Laura, and Phil for joining us for this special panel, and hope to see you guys in person in 2021, let's hope.
Bye.
Thanks, guys.